we will talk about the indifference curves analysis. The indifference curves analysis, it's a tool of understanding how the people put their purchasing plans about goods and services. When we talk about the indifference curves, we use the concept market basket. Market basket, it's the combination of goods and services available for consumption over a certain period. A market basket, it means a group of units of good A and good B. For example, when we have many of market basket have the same utility or the same satisfaction, we put them in indifference curve. So indifference curve is a graph of all the combination of market basket among which the person is indifferent. It's indifferent for the person to get any point or any market basket from the same indifference curve. All of them give the consumer the same satisfaction or the same utility. When we put all group of indifference curves in the same graph, it called indifference map. Indifference map, it shows a group of indifference curves, or it's a way for describing the person's preferences. As we see in the graph, we have two commodities or two goods. It's the gasoline per month by gallons and the expenditure on other goods per month. When we rank or when we put the market basket, the same market basket, we will be in the same indifference curve. And we have many of indifference curves in the indifference map. People can rank the market basket from the most to the least desired. If we have a basket A preferred to basket B, it means the basket A in the higher indifference curve than the basket B. As we see in the graph, U1 is indifference curve is the least desired than U2. U2 is preferred than U1. U3 is preferred than U2. And indifference curves are sloping downward. Sloping downward, it means we have different quantities from the two goods that represented in the horizontal and the vertical axis. Indifference curves further out from the original point to a highest level, it means a highest level of satisfaction for the person. So the people always prefer more of goods and services, not less of these goods, and the amount of money that the people will give up to obtain additional unit of a given good will decrease as more we have of these good, as we know by the marginal utility. Our marginal utility decreased when we have more units from the same good or the same commodity, so we pay less money to have more units from the same good or the same commodity. We see here the budget constraint line. Budget constraint line represented according to our income and the prices of goods and services. If we have the same two commodities or the same two goods, gasoline per month and expenditure on the other goods per month on the vertical X, if we spend all of our income, if we have income equal $100, if we spend all the income or all the $100 to get gasoline, we will be in point B and we will have 10 units of gasoline or 10 gallons of gasoline. If we will spend all of our income on expenditure of other goods per month, we will be in point A, or we will be in any point on the line or in the budget line AB. For example, point D, it represented we will spend $40 in gallons of gasoline and we will get 40 unit, and the rest of the income $60 will be spent on the other goods per month. So we will be in point D. The consumer can afford only those market baskets on the gasoline and other goods per month on or below the budget line. So the consumer can't be afford to be in the point C. Point C, it's according to income and the prices more than the current prices and the current income. In the graph, we put all of the indifference curves together, or the indifference map with the budget line. So we will have the consumer equilibrium. Consumer equilibrium, it's the intersection point between the budget line and the highest indifference curve. Why we choose the highest indifference curve? Because we need as a consumers a high utility or a high level of satisfaction. So the market basket corresponding in the point E is the one that gives the consumer highest possible level of utility or possible level of satisfaction according to his budget line. So the point E is the optimal point, or it's the point of the consumer equilibrium. The budget constraint line can be changed by changing the income or changing the prices of the two goods or the two commodities. For example, if we have a changing in the income, an increase in the income will shift the budget line out parallel to itself. If we have a decrease in the income, it will be shifted inward also parallel to itself, as we see in the graph. AB will be shifted out to be A dash B dash when we have increasing in income. If we have a changes in the price of a good X in the horizontal X, changing in the price of good X rotate the budget constraint line to a new intercept on the XX. For example, if we have increase in the price of a good X, it means the budget line will be shifted from AB to AB dash, and we will have less quantities of the good X. If we have decrease in the price of a good X, it means we will have more quantities of it. So the budget constraint line AB will be shifted to be AB dash. Note that the quantity of expenditure on other goods per month in the vertical X will be at point A, in spite of changing the price of good X, because the price of other goods be fixed or still constant. We see in this graph the income and substitution effect. We have the two goods, gasoline per month by gallons and expenditure on other goods per month. We have point E1, it's the consumer equilibrium. At the point E1, it's the intersection point between the indifference curve U2 and the budget line, as we have according to our income. We have income $100 and the price of gasoline is $1 per gallon. So our budget line is the line begins with 100 and ending by QX. E1, as we said, it's the consumer equilibrium according to the income and the prices of gasoline and other goods. When we have, or when we put a tax on the gasoline, For example, if we have a tax by $1 per gallon, so the price of gallons will increase to be $2 per gallon. $2 per gallon, it means we have a shifting in the budget line. The new budget line will be begins by 100 in the vertical X and 50 in the horizontal X, which means we have a less quantity of gasoline by the income according to the new prices. We have increasing in the prices according to the taxes. So the equilibrium or the new equilibrium for the consumer will be E2. At E2 we have a less quantity of gallons or of gasoline by 40, so it decreased from 60 at point E1 to 40 at E2, and the quantity of expenditures on other goods will be decreased also from 40 at E1 to 20 at E2. If we have an increase in our income by $50, it will shift the budget line outward parallel to the original one. So our new budget line will be begins by 150 in the vertical X, and the new equilibrium will be point E dash. E dash, it's the new equilibrium for the consumer. It's the intersection point between the indifference curve U2 and the new budget line. In E2, the quantity that the consumer can purchase from the gasoline will increase from 40 to 45, and the quantity of purchasing other goods will increase from 20 to 60. Note that the price of the gasoline still as it is, $2 per unit after the taxes. So when we have a new increasing in the budget, not all this increasing will be for the gasoline, just we will have an increase from 40 to 45 by $10, and the rest of the increasing by $40, it will be the difference between 20 and 60 dollars expenditures on the other goods per month. The substitution effect, it's the difference between 45 and 60 gallons, and the income effect will be the difference between 40 and 45. So the substitution effect can be observed if the consumer were given an increase in income to offset the decline of satisfaction caused by increasing the price of gasoline. As we know, we have increasing in the price of gasoline according to the taxes. The law of demand represents the inverse relationship between the price and the quantity demanded. Here in the graph, we have the demand curve, which represents this inverse relationship as we have in the law of demand. When the price decreases, the quantity demanded will increase, so the demand curve sloping downward. The demand curve also represents our marginal benefit. It will be decreased when we have more units according to the law of diminishing marginal utility. When we have more units from the same good, we have less utility or we have less of marginal benefit. So when we have more quantities, we have less marginal benefits. The consumer surplus is the difference between the marginal benefit for the quantity that the consumer get and its market price. when we pay the market price, it's our cost to get this quantity, for example, of gasoline, and we get from this quantity a marginal benefit. The difference between our cost as a market price and our benefit as a marginal benefit, it will be the consumer surplus. So the area BAB measures the marginal surplus or the net benefit that the consumer received from consuming Q1 as a quantity of gasoline. Price elasticity of demand measures the responsiveness of the quantity demanded to the change in the price, or measures the percentage change in the quantity demanded due to the given percentage change in the price. As we see in the equation, we have the percentage change in the quantity demanded divided by the percentage change in the price. By the same concept, we have also price elasticity of supply. It's the responsiveness of the quantity supplied to the changing in the price. The price will change first, and then the quantity will be respond for this changing in the price. So the percentage change in the quantity supply in the response to any given changing in the price will be the price elasticity of supply. As we see in the equation, the percentage change in the quantity supplied divided by the percentage change in the price. We can use the indifference curve analysis to understand the choices to give up leisure time to obtain more of the working time represented by the income per day. Here in the graph, we have in the horizontal x leisure hours, and the vertical x represented the income per day. U1, U2, U3, it's our indifference curve represented a highest possible level of daily well-being, and the line AB, it's like the budget line, represented according to our hours per day. 24, we have 24 hours per day. So the point E represented a combination of a leisure hours per day and the income per day, or the working hours, that they give the worker the greatest, highest possible level of well-being. We need the highest point. It means the highest level of well-being for the worker. So in the equilibrium, the person will have 16 leisure hours per day, and the rest of the day it will be 8 hours for a working day, for a working hours. Now we will shift to the producer side and talk about production and the cost. When we talk about the production and the cost, we talking about the production function. It's the maximum output that can we obtain from a given combination of inputs. Our inputs like land, the labor, any raw material or any material capital in a given technology. So the production function, it means the maximum output that can we have from our inputs. We have two periods in the production. We have the short run. It's the time frame in which the quantity of one or more than one of our resources used in the production is fixed. The long run is the time frame in which all the quantities of all inputs or all resources, including the plant size, can be varied or can be changed. So in the long run, all the inputs are changed, but in the short run, just one or more than one, but at least one of our resources is fixed. We use isoquant analysis to have the minimum cost method for producing a certain quantity of units. Here in the graph, we have the blue curve. It's the iso quant curve. Each point in this curve represent a combination of a machine's hours and labor hours that can be used to produce the monthly output Q1. And the lines by the plaque, it's the iso-cost line. It means, or it represented the costs of groups of machines hours and labor hours. The most optimal point, it's the point E. It represented the minimum cost method for producing Q1. It's the least cost that can we have as a producers produce the monthly output Q1. So Q1, it can be produced by K star as a machine hours and L star as a labor hours. As we know, we have many types of markets. For example, we have a perfect competitive market. We have a monopoly market. Here we will talk about the perfectly competitive market. The perfectly competitive market has many features like all the productive resources are privately owned. All the buyers and sellers dealing with a standardized products or homogeneous product, which means all the products in the market have the same quality, the same characteristics, the same weight, the same color, and so on. We have a huge number of buyers and sellers, so we have no single buyer or seller can influence the price. Each firm is a price taker. It's a price taker because it can't make any influence on the price, or it can't control the price. All the relevant information is available to all buyers and sellers. Also, all buyers and sellers seek to maximize their gains from trading. For example, for the consumer, he is trying to maximize his utility, and for the producer, he trying to maximize his profit by producing the output when the price equal the marginal cost, or P equal MC. In the short run, the competitive firm can maximize its profit in the point when the marginal cost equal price. Marginal cost equal the price in point E, which represented the output per month at Q star. Before Q star, or before the equilibrium point between marginal cost and the price, the producer have a surplus when the marginal cost is less than the price. But after the point E, the marginal cost is more than the price, which means the producer make or gain loses. So the optimal point in the short run to maximize the profit for the competitive firm is the point E, where P equal marginal cost, or where the price equals the marginal cost. In the long run, the equilibrium will be at the point when P equal long run marginal cost equal long run average cost. It's the point, as we see in the graph, when the quantity will be Q star. In the Q star, we have the level of zero economic profits. We don't have any economic profit, or we don't have any losses. We have just the normal profits, or a zero economic profits.